mothers tended to not pick up on their children's emotional distress as mothers did. The father of one 10-year-old was aware of the ghastly circumstances his son endured at school, but insisted on him staying. Eventually, the father gave in and let the son leave. "Father," the boy said, "if you hadn't let me leave, I would have thrown myself under a train." As early as 1934, the Central Organization of Jews in Germany reported that many children were showing signs of psychological disturbance. One answer to the traumatic experience of the children was enrollment in Jewish schools. In 1933, there were about 60,000 school-aged Jewish children in Germany. The percentage attending Jewish schools rocketed from 14% in 1932 to 52% in 1936. Communities provided at the peak of demand 167 schools. Keeping them going was not easy. Funds were scarce and many teachers were emigrating. Berlin provided the best choice with one Oberschule, one Mittelschule, and 8 primary or Volksschulen. There were also private Jewish schools. All Jewish schools provided the normal German curriculum, as well as teaching of Judaism, Jewish history, and culture. Lottie Kaliski, founder of a private school in Berlin in 1931, noted, "Most of us come from very assimilated backgrounds, and so do the children. In order to give them a more positive attitude, they had to know something about their background." Many of the children attending these schools learned about Judaism and celebrated holidays for the very first time. Some schools prepare the children for emigration by teaching for the British matriculation exam or the American College Boards, and had courses as well in gardening and Hebrew. Jewish schools provided a haven for children. Recalling his relief at entering a Jewish school at the age of 15, a man said, "There was no longer a picture of the Führer on the wall, and no unseemly brawls, and no singing of Nazi fighting songs. Liberated, I was allowed to breathe freely." This sense of safety led to anti-Nazi pranks by the teenagers. They would dress up and imitate, they would parody Hitler and Goebbels to the absolute intense enjoyment and hilarity of their schoolmates. It was a little bit dangerous, even in the sheltered surroundings of a Jewish school, because of course the Gestapo could come in unannounced at any time, but they provided a huge amount of relief for their fellow pupils. And they also, on the outside, after school, would do forbidden things. They would go to cafes and to any place else in public that they felt like going, which they weren't permitted to do as Jews. And they even produced anti-Nazi graffiti, which they daubed on the walls. In other words, they were quite normal teens, pushing the boundaries, refusing to accept the restrictions that were set upon them. A vital and an intense life continued. For the young, the main coping behavior was to leave. Many teenagers realized the danger they were in and begged their parents to flee. Ruth Sass told her parents about her experiences and urged them to leave Germany. Their bewildered response was very typical of their generation. How could they pack up and leave? Where would they go? How could they start a new business in a foreign language? What country would take them in? And finally, and most important of all for so many families, what would happen to grandmother? Ruth finally gave up. "It's become more and more clear to me that I had to leave Germany, my home, my parents, the nice, secure life that I knew." She left for Geneva, where she finished her education. 14-year-old Miriam Karlbach in 1936 was very aware of what was going on around her. The parades of Hitler Youth, the anti-Semitic propaganda, the boycotts of Jewish shops, on, the restrictions of where Jews could shop. The landlord forced her family out of their flat. Many of her relatives were fleeing. In 1938, just age 16, she decided on her own that it was time to leave Germany for Palestine. When she received her passport with the next necessary exit visa, it also had a stamp showing that she would never be allowed to return. By 1939, 83% of young people aged 16 to 25 had gone. 82% of the under 16s had fled either with family or on kinder transports. The youth left behind. For those left behind, Jewish youth groups became sources of fellowship, distraction, and hope. Before 1933, many Jewish youngsters had belonged to non-sectarian groups, while Jewish organizations attracted only a minority. In 1932, 25 to 30% belonged to Jewish associations, such as the non-Zionist Kameraden for those liking German culture, the Orthodox Ezra group for the religious, and for the Zionists, the Blau Weiss. There were also many Jewish sports clubs and fraternities. By 1930, 60% of youth had joined a Jewish group, and by 1933, 60% of those were in Zionist groups. This cohesion of Jewish youth accentuated a pre-existing generation gap. Deeply acculturated parents clung to what they had in Germany. The young saw no future for themselves in the land of their birth. Parents, well before the 1930s, had opposed Zionism both politically and philosophically. The response of Margot Spiegel is a good example of how young German Jews changed to adapt to their new reality. Strongly attached to her German heritage with a love of nature and the ideals of Schiller and Goethe, she had belonged to a non-sectarian hiking and singing club where she was made to feel unwelcome under the new regime. She withdrew and sought out Jewish teens in her town of Konstanz who were organizing for the first time. They had, young Jews all, lived in the same town without knowing one another. Suddenly, they wanted to know about Jewish history, tradition, and the Bible. They were searching for an understanding of what had happened to their lives and why. They gradually became fully committed Zionists, much to the disgust of Margot's father, who was a decorated World War I veteran. He didn't speak to his daughter for weeks. Despite the parental disapproval, young Jews flourished on the activities set up by the private and community groups. A hostel, Haus Bertha, was set up in July 1934 by the Jewish War Veterans Organization for use by Jewish groups when the youngsters were no longer welcome and eventually no longer permitted to use German youth hostels. Sports, hikes, and lectures on Jewish themes all provided recreation, but also, according to one 16-year-old boy, it gave him the backbone that he needed for emigration. By 1936, agriculture and other training courses, both in Germany and by 1936 in 10 different European countries, which also prepared Jewish youngsters for leaving home. In contrast to the flight of Jewish youth, by 1939, the number of Jews in Germany over the age of 60 decreased by only 27%. By 1941, two-thirds of the population was past middle age. In less than 8 years, two-thirds of German Jews emigrated, leaving a disproportionate number of old people and women. Jewish newspapers told of old women, more than 28,000 of whom were widows in 1939, whose children had emigrated, who no longer had the servants they'd been used to, who were living in absolute poverty in drastically reduced quarters. They constituted a community of old people who supported and consoled one another. When Elizabeth Freund, one of the last people to leave Germany legally in October of 1941, went to the Gestapo for her exit papers, she saw old people, old women, all old people waiting in line. Elderly Jewish people became refugees within their own country, evicted from their apartments, moving off multiple times, always to smaller and worse accommodation, while still working long shifts of forced labor. One Berlin widow, whose four children had emigrated but whose own efforts to leave had failed, had to leave her apartment in April 1940, first to a one-room sublet, then to another unheated room, and finally to a room in a Judenhauser, which she shared with a stranger. By 1943, the few remaining Jews and some Aryans in non-privileged mixed marriage lived in these houses, which were holding accommodation for deportation. The Gestapo regularly burst into these houses, searching for forbidden food, checking to make sure that the Stars of David were sewed onto clothing properly. They stole, they punched, they kicked, they slapped the elderly residents. Victor Klemperer, living as the Jewish partner in a mixed marriage, wrote, "Fear and hunger fill the day. Will I be beaten up and spat at today?" Despite the noise, overcrowding, and lack of privacy, Jews living in Judenhausen created a community of connection and concern. Orthodox and liberals, those baptized as Catholic and Protestant, the formerly rich and poor, the highly educated, and those from very simple social circles, had to live and get along together. We had become a true community. But the Nazi division of Jews into privileged and non-privileged categories caused jealousy and hatred, according to Victor Klemperer's diary. Privileged Jews received the same rations as Germans, could use public transport, and didn't wear the Star of David. Cohesion included turning to religion. Rabbi Yosef Karlbach received increasing numbers of queries about Jewish ritual and law, inspiring him to stay on with his family to serve the needs of the remnant community in Germany. As late as 1943, regular prayer services were held in Hamburg, where a new mikveh was built. In Bonn, there were also regular services held in a Judenhaus, including a wedding celebrated the night before a young couple were deported. Outside Munich, Orthodox Jews prayed in the cloister of a convent where they had been shut. Sabbath and holidays were celebrated even in the Jewish hospital in Berlin, which was the last official residence of Jews in Germany. Despite the Nazis' success in segregating and expelling Jews from German society, Jewish communities and organizations persevered and offered religious, cultural, and social semblance of normalcy to those who adjusted to their persecutors' torments by going on with their lives as best they could. Many highly assimilated Jews sought cohesion for the first time to their community for support. Rabbi Leo Beck commented to a colleague in June 41 that German Jews were succeeding in their struggle to maintain schools, religious observance, and charity. We've already seen that there was a great divide in the attitude towards emigration between young and old, at least until November 1938. It was only after that stupefying unleashing of state-organized violence that Jews were convinced that they faced physical danger. After the pogrom, essentially everybody tried to find a possibility of emigrating. While it was still possible to leave, although difficult and a protracted and exhausting process, men and women differed in their attitudes. It was usually women who saw the danger signals first and urged their husbands to go. Since 1933, the Nazis had attacked Jewish men first, demolishing their careers and businesses and arresting them. leaving women to carry the burden of maintaining their homes and families, of keeping the households and communities together. By 1939, only 16% of Jewish men had any employment. Women, many of whom for the first time had to leave the comfort and comparative safety of their homes to take over the roles of providing for their families, and pleading for the release of their husbands and sons from prison and concentration camps. Don't forget, in 1938, there was a massive amount, over 30,000 Jewish men were put into detention, into concentration camps. So the women's job, apart from everything else they had to do, was to try to get their men out. And you weren't permitted to be released from, let's say, Sachsenhausen, unless you had valid emigration papers. And then, of course, the Nazis made it virtually impossible to get them. They did everything they could to slow up the process and stall. So these women were running around trying to organize emigration and going back and forth trying to get their men set free. It was women who on a daily basis dealt with the real world of the street, dealing with food and clothing shopping that became ever more restricted and dangerous, coping with aggressive neighbors, spending hours filling forms. In 1935, Marta Appel gives a conversation amongst friends concerning a doctor who had just emigrated. The women all took the doctor's part and said, oh, it took much more courage to leave than to stay. The men disagreed, including her husband, a rabbi, who argued that it was unimaginable to leave our homeland and all the duties that make up a man's life. Women, of course, were not as integrated into public life, although many had jobs. And after they were no longer permitted to work in anything but Jewish businesses, many of which had folded up, they did a huge amount of community service. They worked for the various Jewish organizations as social service providers. Jewish men had more to lose economically, and many wouldn't bring themselves to abandon their life work, the colleagues and clients, before their businesses or professional practices had collapsed or been Aryanized. Going underground. Choosing an illegal underground existence was the coping mechanism of Jews in the latter part of the war in Germany. Nothing had prepared law-abiding, middle-class, middle-aged German Jews psychologically or practically for survival in hiding. Most hiders were aged 12 to 59 years old. By August 1942, a Berlin Jewish woman, Erna Becker Cohen, noticed a big drop in the number of yellow stars on the streets of the city. Those Jews remaining had either gone into hiding or were in mixed marriages, which ultimately didn't save them, but which did give protection until the very last. Known as U-boats, they referred to their condition as submerged, untergetaucht. Most Jews who hid did so after official notices of deportation ended. Now, what happened was, starting in 1941, when the deportation started, you would receive, usually with about a week's grace, a notice saying, in so many days' time, you will report to such and such a place for evacuation, as it was called, euphemistically. But then, with the spikes in suicide occurring in 1938 and then again in 1941, when these notices came out, because in that intervening week, many Jewish people would kill themselves rather than be deported. So the Nazis were angered at the number of suicides that removed Jews from their control. And they started arbitrary roundups in late 1942. By then, they'd just come and snatch, no notification. By then, the Jewish understanding of their plight had changed. Friends and relatives had already been deported, and rumors were spreading about what waited at the end of the railway journey. After parents and elderly relations were taken, many decided that the time had come to hide, many of the remaining family members. In February 1943, there was something called the factory action, in which 10,000 Jewish forced laborers. And by the way, all during this time, most Jews of working age were working as forced laborers in whatever the Nazis decided to task to they had to fulfill. 10,000 Jewish forced laborers were dragged out of factories and deported, 7,000 of these being rounded up in Berlin. It was a big shock to the Jewish forced laborers who thought they'd been safe in war production jobs. A good number were warned and didn't go into work that day, but into hiding instead. The numbers that went underground is estimated at 10 to 12,000, of whom only about 25% survived. Although some Jews prepared in advance, most sought refuge spontaneously. In 1942, 23-year-old Erna Puttman knocked on a friend's door. "Today they took my mother. Then you will stay here." The hider friend and her three children shared their two rooms with Erna for the rest of the war. Most Jews in hiding, however, kept moving, occasionally aided by resistance groups, and it's calculated that it took 300 Germans to hide 68 Jews. Inga Deutschkorn and her mother hid with 12 different people in as many places in 27 months. In Weiden, a woman hid in 23 different places in 2 years. Another woman with two daughters spent 2.5 years outside of Berlin wandering from village to village. She had a map and she didn't visit any village more than once. One of her daughters was fair-haired. She dyed her hair blonde, never told anyone that she was Jewish, and posed as a bombed-out refugee. And by this stage in the war, that was quite plausible because the Allies were bombing like mad. Once the Allied bombing began, and in Berlin, particularly during massive raids in August 43, identity papers became available. Jews in hiding and those hiding them lived in constant fear of discovery or denouncement. Most horribly, one coping behavior of a few Jews was to act as a catcher. In Berlin, there were 15 to 20 of these Jews, hired by the Gestapo and paid with immunity if they hunted down and denounced other Jews. Of course, they were killed themselves when they were no longer useful. It didn't make any sense to do it. I mean, it wasn't of any use. The most famous in Berlin was Stella Goldschlag, the blonde Lorelei. In one weekend, she led the Gestapo to 62 hiding Jews in apartments, cafes, and on the street. Jews in hiding feared everyone. Any neighbor, block warden, postman, grocer could denounce them. Jews in hiding and their rescuers became weary of endless days of deception. Hiding took a great psychological toll for both hiders and hidden and required enormous courage and will to survive, but also another quality that doesn't really leap to mind straight away, and that was patience. Most of us are probably familiar with the Anne Frank story and how in hiding the Frank family couldn't make any noise during the day and had to tiptoe around and were very restricted in their movements. And doing that day after day, the toll that that took on some people couldn't cope with it and just ran out into the street and were picked up straight away. Berlin was the best place to be for those in hiding seeking support, as there were by now few Jews elsewhere. Many of the Berlin submerged developed a Jewish underground grapevine, meeting in cafes to swap information, to warn of the whereabouts of catchers, to trade knowledge of availability of false identity papers, and even to alert fellow U-boats of the possible escape routes, smuggling routes out of Germany, as people did get smuggled out. There were some small groups, such as that of Felice Schragenheim, who with her 10 friends helped other Jews acquire false IDs and find hiding places. Jewish women had been active in both all Jewish and mixed anti-fascist resistance groups, following on from groups before 1933. Two larger resistance groups, the Hughaluzi and the Baum group, engaged in a broad range of oppositionist activities, including posting true war news in factories and anti-Nazi slogans wherever possible. The latter pro-communist association had formed around Herbert Baum just before the war, and by 1941 had a core of 30 young people. They offered help to Jews in hiding, but also printed and distributed anti-fascist leaflets and studied Marxism together. Only four members of the inner group survived. An all-woman Jewish group led by Eva Mamlock and active in Berlin was wiped out, leaving only one survivor. There were also individuals such as Edith Wolf. She was the child of an Aryan mother and a Jewish father. He was deported and murdered. And she, having been baptized as a child, then converted to Judaism at the age of 19 in 1933 to show solidarity and started a one-woman anti-Nazi campaign, leaving leaflets in phone booths, tucked into library books and in other public places, even sending threatening postcards to Nazi officials. Because her aunt had removed Edith's name from the registry of the Jewish community, she was able to use her protected Mischling status to procure food and to conceal young Jews from being rounded up for deportation. When the final roundup of Jews began in February 43, she helped to organize the Hughaluzi and after the war emigrated to Palestine. The very small number of Jews involved in organized resistance has provoked the question, why didn't they do more to fight back? If you measure the estimated number of 2,000 Jews active in anti-fascist resistance between 33 and 43, proportionately to the German population, it would be the equivalent of 600,000 to 700,000 German activists. And there was nowhere near that number of German anti-fascist resistors. One historian, who is himself a survivor, wrote, "The belief that Jews as a group could have waged something like direct political resistance in a Nazified country whose own democratic organs had failed miserably or had been brutally destroyed belongs quite simply to the realm of fantasy." On the 3rd of June 1934, the Jewish community of Worms celebrated the 900th anniversary of the foundation of the old synagogue. No single city official or non-Jew participated in the ceremony. According to legend, in Roman times, the Jews of Worms had declined to participate in the Sanhedrin elections in Jerusalem, claiming to have built their own New Jerusalem on the banks of the Rhine. By the end of 1934, a quarter of the Worms community had emigrated. The New Jerusalem on the banks of the Rhine may have been an illusion, but assimilated German Jews, by denying their Nazi persecutors, murderers, complete control over their daily lives, remained faithful to their human integrity, protecting their self-respect, even in choosing to go through the door marked no exit. Thank you.
Both my parents were refugees from just before the war. My father was on the Kinder transport. I would know a lot about the Jewish community life, Orthodox Jewish community life, between 1933 and 1939. My dad writes that he was aware of the politics at the national level, but he was much more aware of the politics of who was going to be on the Shul committee. This was much more of a subject, who would be on the synagogue committee, than what was going on at a national level. And what occurs to me, and this is where today's talk was an absolute eye-opener for me, is that the only, and I know a lot about that period, but it seems to me now I only know it through the prism of organized Orthodox Jewish communities. One in Frankfurt, where my mother was from, and one in Berlin, where my father was from. And that, however bad things got, and they got very bad, the fact that you had a community that could operate under the radar, even if there was no synagogue anymore, must have been some sort of safety valve that assimilated Jews, who didn't understand what they were being, what they were doing in that category in the first place, didn't have. And of course, suicide would hardly ever be an option for Orthodox Jews, which again, I think, accentuates why suicide was the only option that assimilated Jews who'd lost everything. And my last comment would be that Orthodox Jews, committed Jews, would have a much longer DNA memory of persecution. It didn't matter how well my grandfather could quote Schiller and sing Wagner, which he used to do at home, which seems to me to be unbelievably ridiculous, but he did. Very proud. Him and my grandma used to sing along, doing arias together at home. But Jews who were committed Jews knew that it hadn't always been so, and that Jews had always been potential targets of persecution. And I think that's what came across with what you said today, Katherine, that people who didn't have that and who had consciously tried to get rid of any vestiges of Jewish identity and Jewish memory, they were all the more susceptible to this incredible shock, which they responded to by, among other things, suicide. So, a real eye-opener, and thank you. It's an amazing amount of research and much appreciated.